Instead of looking at the world situation, the problems right now, let's look at the remedy. Because that's the only thing that's really important. Is there a remedy? There is. Are we using this remedy? We're not. And therein lies the problem. So if we knew what the remedy was, we wouldn't even need to focus on the world's problems. Because we'd simply apply the remedy and that would be it. We wouldn't need to parse it and dissect it and study the world's problems, and because there is one sovereign remedy for all the world's problems. One sovereign remedy. So it's that which we have to look at. That's the real important focus and use of time. The real remedy is to look upon that which cannot suffer loss. That is the remedy. Because the problems of existence all have to do with loss. Existence is really a dream of loss. And loss comes in infinite varieties, seemingly. Yet it's all simply the same. It's just loss. It's the suffering of loss. So, by looking upon that which cannot suffer loss, we are freed from the dream of loss. The problem is we refuse to look upon that which cannot suffer loss. That is our problem. It's everyone's problem. We all have exactly the same problem. So by focusing in on this very carefully, we are addressing everyone's problem in the world. Why has it remained so difficult? I've been trying to explicate this and show what is it that keeps us from looking upon that which can't suffer loss. And someday it will become so simple we will look upon that which cannot suffer loss, unconditional love. But right now we're struggling. So let's once again try and bring our focus to bear upon why we struggle. What are we struggling with? It boils down to the fact that the belief in loss cannot look upon that which can't suffer loss. Cannot look upon it. Why? Because it sees nothing there. Cannot see it. It sees nothing. If there's a belief that gives rise to perception, the scenario of loss that we are seem to be perceiving, we call it existence, that produces a perception of itself, of loss. And this perception only sees loss because that's what is believed in. When this belief perception tries to look within and see unconditional love, there's no loss there, so it can't see anything. Cannot see anything. It's like a complete void. Worse than that, an endless nothingness, a voidness, annihilation, a lack of identity, lack of being, nothing there whatsoever. From the standpoint of loss-based perception, which is sensory perception, loss-based perception, can't see anything. So it turns around in error and says, oh my gosh, don't look there. There's nothing there at all. And so therein lies the problem. If we expect loss-based perception to see non-loss, that which cannot suffer loss in any way, then we're at an impasse. And we've been at this impasse for quite some time. And we say, well, can't it be symbolized somehow in loss? Can't we use the format of loss to somehow symbolize that which cannot suffer loss? You know, can't we get a painting of it, a picture of it, something that we can perceive using loss-based perception? And the answer is, well, it would be set in the context of loss, and therefore it's useless to us, really, really useless. It'd give us a faint, fuzzy echo in some way, but it's really not, doesn't do the job. Our perception that we have in existence, our perception we're utilizing is the perception of loss. And we're trying to make loss beautiful. But that perception cannot see non-loss. Nothing there. It will look for a seam, right? It will look for where is the point where it turns to loss. You know, it's looking for that edge, the seam, where what it is turns into something else. Where's the change? It's looking for the change. Where's the change? That which can't suffer loss doesn't change. Unconditional love doesn't change. It's changeless. So, once again, the perception, loss-based perception, which is what we are so used to, cannot see it. And not only that, it's terrified of looking in that direction, saying that there's no identity there. There's nothing there. It's like falling off the edge of the world into an eternal abyss. It's absolutely terrified. Because loss-based perception sees identity in loss. See, I'm not this, I'm not that. This is what I am, but if I do that, I would suffer loss here, loss there. Everything is based on a loss. So identity, life, everything it defines is based on perceiving loss. And with no loss, it would seem like a loss of identity, a loss of being, a loss of life, loss of mind, loss of sanity, everything. Because it would just see no way to define itself. No way to bring about any definition, that loss-based definition. Everything in existence is based on loss, defined upon loss, everything. So this is the impasse. Can't see it. We won't, even if we turn in that direction, we couldn't see it. It's not possible for loss-based perception to see that which does not suffer loss. So when people talk about waiting, they're tired of waiting. This refers to, we're tired of waiting for a means to see that which cannot suffer loss. We are told by those who can see it that there is a means to see it, but it's a means that has to be given to us. It's not a means that we can construct. There's nothing we can do with our perception to see this. So we are tired of waiting. It's frustrating, definitely frustrating, because there is this impasse. However, what we can do is clarify this impasse. And what I see is that through clarifying this impasse, we are paving the way for this, what's called vision. It's called the vision of Christ, which is just one way referred to it, which means the capacity to see that which cannot suffer loss. It's an internal vision. It's a new vision. Jesus called the new life, being born again. We're born in this world. What are we born into? We're born into the perception of loss. So a new life would be born into the perception of no loss. That would be the new life. But we need a new perceptibility, a new ability of perception that is not the sensory perception apparatus, which the body is the sensory apparatus. So what I'm doing, what these videos are doing, is clarifying this impasse, which is all we really can do. It's not a waste of time. Now, reason can clarify the impasse. It cannot itself see non-loss. It can see the need for that, That's as far as it can go. It sees very clearly the need for it and how it fits and how it's right. And it sees all of that, but it, reason itself doesn't see non-loss. It's a tool we use to sort of level the ground so the foundation can be set upon that level ground. But we have to actually go even beyond reason. We have to have a new perceptibility, a new means of perception. That's a fact. Because if perception thinks it sees it, our loss-based perception, it will simply fragment it into and see all the boundaries and the edges and the borders and all the loss, all the potential loss here and there. It cannot hold this, cannot hold the vision of non-loss at all. Cannot do it. So again, we have this colossal impasse. Now the promise that we've been told is that this vision is bestowed upon us when we're ready for it. That is the promise we've been given. And we would like that promise to be fulfilled. All I can say is that we have not gotten enough clarification, haven't used a reason enough to clarify, haven't leveled everything out enough so that this vision has not yet been bestowed upon us. I guess that's something that we have to take on faith. I continue to try and take this on faith. I can see that it is absolutely necessary. Absolutely necessary. That which believes in loss. See, the dynamic is so profound and inescapable. I've gone over that and over it and over it in other videos. So here I want to focus on the impasse on this video. The necessity to clarify and accept there is this impasse. And the only way to get past it is for this bestowal of vision. Vision of oneness. Vision of no lostness. Vision of unconditional love. That which doesn't change, that which is already equally distributed everywhere. If there's already an equal distribution everywhere, and no desire for that to ever change, then where can the loss take place? Where is the loss taking place? There isn't any. You see? So it would be a vision of that which has equal distribution everywhere with no desire, a purpose to change that in any way. No desire to give more to something and less to another. No desire to have more at this time and less at another time. No desire to more at this place and less at some other place. So in all times, places, and situations, it has no desire to have more or less. It is equally distributed everywhere. And no change in that. So there's no loss. That's called unconditional love. The overlay. I call it the overlay. That which overlays all apparent loss. So that all the forms that we're used to, where we're used to playing with loss, those forms can remain, and yet they do not suffer loss. They do not cause any loss in unconditional love. The play of loss dances, but the overlay remains perfectly still and calm. And yet again, we cannot perceive this unchangingness through sensory perception, through the body's perception. So the body is not seen as valuable for that at all. Body doesn't really have any value as far as seeing non-loss. Seeing non-loss is a spiritual perception. It is a perception from reality. It's reality perceiving itself, as it were. A reality holding up a mirror to itself. Perception is a mirror. Perception is not used in reality. Direct experiencing is how reality functions. direct experiencing of essence. It's beyond perception. Vastly, you know, better than in perception. However, a mirror can be held up to reality, and that would be vision, spiritual vision of seeing that which doesn't change, which is already equally distributed everywhere, with, again, never changing that fact. A trillion years from now, as existence sees time, with all the changes in time and space and situations, unconditional love will be exactly the same, equal distribution everywhere. That's already the case right now. It's always been the case from the very beginning of the loss-based scenario that Spirit dreamed up, so that Spirit could pretend to be Prime Creator, could pretend that there was a way to become Prime Creator. That is, this whole loss-based scenario is Spirit believing that there is some way for it to become Prime Creator, to change reality. From the very moment that this was entertained by Spirit, the remedy was also present, which is this unconditional love that overlays the entire scenario of loss, equal distribution everywhere. It's the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator, not trying to find a way to be Prime Creator. Therefore, there doesn't have to be, in this idea, there doesn't have to be any loss at all. None. Doesn't have to be any more or less. No change. Nothing suffering at the expense, nothing gaining at the expense of anything else. You see? No loss. Perfect equality. So that's been there since from the very beginning. It'll be there always. Will always be the counterpart to the dream of loss, this hypothetical scenario that there's a way to change reality. There's a way to annihilate what truth. And we've talked about this at length in other videos, how existence is really trying to annihilate itself, completely destroy itself, and through the complete destruction, it believes it will destroy that which is gave rise to it as well, knowing that cause and effect are one. The one that was holding the idea, if complete annihilation of the idea could take place, that means the one holding the idea would also have to be annihilated. And what I discovered, a great discovery, is that this annihilation, complete annihilation, actually just ends up being a symbolic annihilation. It's just all symbolic. It's just total chaos, but it's all symbolic. And the one who is holding the idea remains. So it's all a waste of time. It will never take place. Total annihilation does not annihilate the one holding the idea. So all that happens is there's this total chaos that is just symbolic. That's as far as it goes. So it's a waste of time. This whole loss-based scenario is a waste of time. And yet the remedy for it is we have to see that which cannot suffer any loss. Because this loss-based scenario is so totally foreign to reality. We ourselves feel that we're foreign to reality. We feel we'd be foreigners, strangers in that land, in the land of reality, where there's no loss. We feel we wouldn't fit in at all. See, we feel we fit in here in this world. But the truth is, we really don't. For instance, from my own testimony, I don't feel like I fit in here at all. I feel a total stranger in this world. Stranger in a strange land here. That's really, I feel I don't fit in anywhere whatsoever. And that's because I feel I fit into reality. You see, but the more accustomed we are to try to adapt to loss, the more we feel we fit in here. And we gather friends around us that reinforce this notion. And we can gather civilizations around us that reinforce this notion. We gather bodies around us. We clothe ourselves in causal, mental, emotional, etheric energy bodies, and are trying to help us adjust to loss, make us feel that this is our home, this is our purpose, this is what our life, this is what we are, this is our identity. And yet, what we're really subscribing to is our own annihilation, which isn't our identity, which isn't our being, which isn't our purpose really at all. And we really can never adjust to it completely, because the purpose, I experienced a total chaos. We cannot adjust to that. There's nothing to adjust to. It's horrible, and we just reject it and say, I don't want this. So literally, we don't want existence at all. We don't want loss. We just are playing along with it, kind of seeing, you know, what's going to happen here. We're kind of interested in what's going to happen. If we see the end result of it, then we'll reject it. That's what happened to me. I saw the end result of it. I rejected it. I say, I don't want this. And then that turns to the path of, okay, how do we get free of this? Turns to that path. And gradually, then reason shows up, and reason starts to clarify it. And reason says, okay, this is the situation, and you get clued in to it bit by bit. So that's what I'm sharing here, is getting clued into the problem, the impasse. There's an impasse. We literally have to accept vision, and very few have done that. We keep trying to find a way for perception to do it. We keep trying to feed perception with beautiful images. And, we can make it interesting here in our talk. The main thing to sink in is there is this impasse, and it's only bridged through vision. And the vision is something it's there, but it only will ignite, it only will unfold, it will only function when we're somehow willing for it to function, we're ready for it. And all we can do is keep improving our readiness. That's basically all we can really do. And so we just keep doing that. There's no, magic at all in it. It's simply, it is held in abeyance until we are not going to be frightened by it. You see, we don't want to be driven back into the arms of perception of loss by feeling somehow alienated. If we see vision of that which cannot suffer loss, and we feel like we don't fit in there, then we'll rush back into the arms of loss and maybe inflict loss upon ourselves or upon others, that we don't want to do that. So it doesn't come to us until we're stable enough in clarity so that we can appreciate it and accept it for what it is, instead of trying to change it. Because obviously, if we try to change that which cannot be changed, we will feel insignificant and helpless. It will be horrible. We take it the wrong way. So it waits. It waits for us. It's just waiting there. It's just waiting for us to be ready for it. And so these videos and your attention on these videos is very helpful. It brings you closer to that moment where you're ready for vision. Vision of that which cannot suffer loss, unconditional love, perfect peace, perfect peacefulness, meaning undisturbedness. We're just waiting for that. Cannot be perceived with bodily senses. Cannot. And the purpose of existence, of loss, will never look in that direction, because it senses there's nothing there for it. Existence is all about generating loss. Okay, it is a vast sacrificial machine. This dream of existence is a vast sacrificial machine. That's all that it is. We sugarcoat it. We're experts at that. We're experts at inventing all sorts of sugar coatings for it. Candy coated. But still, it's all it is a vast scenario, a sacrificial machine generating loss. That's all that existence does, is generate loss. It's all that it does. Nothing other than that. Everything that's arising is arising for the purpose of suffering loss. Everything. And so existence is totally attuned to loss. The notion of something that cannot suffer loss is completely foreign and alien to existence. The purpose of existence has no utility whatsoever. Zero. So existence looks at that which cannot suffer loss as zero. Nothing. No interest in it. It turns away from it immediately and resolutely. completely rejects it. Completely rejects it. No interest. That is why reason has to come to your aid. Reason's very interested in this vision of no loss. That's all that it's interested in. And it speaks to you in the language you understand, which is the voice of, you know, intellect, reason, understanding, clarity, something you can appreciate. And just explains why it's interested in vision. And then you see, ah, this is really the remedy for all this misery and suffering, all this loss that I've, you know, we've been inflicted, has been inflicted upon ourselves. We've inflicted all this upon ourselves, as it were, upon our sensibilities, as if it were real, like a nightmare, where we're inflicting this nightmare upon us. It doesn't have any effect on what we are. It doesn't have any effect on reality, but it seems to, because we've symbolized ourselves, and then it does affect the symbol of what we are. The symbol of what we are is just being, you know, suffering, constant loss. I mean, this existence is, we believe it's our home, and therefore we believe our home is suffering constant loss. And we're extremely worried about that. It causes tremendous fear. But it's not true. It's not true at all. It's the kind of fear you have in a nightmare, as it were. This loss now. Why are we spending time on this now as opposed to waiting? Because, first of all, it's always right to focus on getting free of this loss-based scenario. Because this loss-based scenario is always horrible. But right now, it is, the loss-based scenario is going to become extra horrible. It's going to be like on steroids. And there is this brutal situation unfolding in existence right here on planet Earth. And it is truly, we have been set up, led down the primrose path very cleverly. And at some point we will find ourselves bound. And we played along up to the point where we find ourselves absolutely bound in an extremely vulnerable situation, and will be brutalized. This planet, it will be brutalized by that part of this scenario, which carries out the loss and the brutality. And it's an effort to destroy all our energy bodies, to deplete ourselves of energy all through the energy bodies, the physical, the etheric energy body, the emotional, the mental, the causal, all those energy bodies that we have used to play with the scenario of loss. It's an attempt to brutalize all of that and bring about destruction of all of that. Yeah, so it's very important now that we realize that there is a remedy to this. That's vision of Christ, vision of that which cannot suffer loss, vision of unconditional love, that we can accept this vision. Very important. Existence is trying to annihilate itself. Energy is symbolic of essence. In reality, there's only essence. There's no energy. Energy is a way, is what arises in this loss-based scenario. It's how this loss-based scenario plays. Light and dark, the duality of constructivity and destructivity, the play of energy, the yin-yang, that's all symbolic. It's not real. It's unreal. It has no meaning because it's futile. It accomplishes absolutely nothing. It's all really, so it's nothing. It's symbolic, has no meaning whatsoever. And yet, in relation to symbols, in relation to other symbols, seem to have meaning. Have symbolic meaning, which is really nothing. But so spirit, which was what we are, symbolized itself in order to imagine that it's part of this loss-based scenario, this dream, and it wrapped itself up, as it were, in symbols, and those symbols are the various bodies, energy bodies, as it were, various ways that it experiences loss, causal, mental, emotional, etheric, various different bodies, however many you want to say. The point of it is that, again, existence is trying to annihilate itself. And through this complete annihilation, it believes it can annihilate that which is holding this idea, which is giving rise to this idea, which is choosing this idea, which is spirit. So spirit is really trying to annihilate itself, trying to destroy reality as it, and so that magically spirit believes that a new reality, that which is bringing about this annihilation, will then have some magical power to create a new reality. It'll be prime creator. So it is existence trying to annihilate itself. It will try to bring about the annihilation of all these energy bodies. And this is the brutality. What is coming is extremely brutal. And it's a way to destroy these subtle energy bodies. And leaving the physical, it's a way to use the physical body to destroy the energy bodies, as it were. It's a very nasty type of situation. And that's coming to this planet now. Which is why there are those who are speaking up on it from many different angles. There are many who are speaking up about this, each one from a slightly different angle, slightly different emphasis, as it were. But I am absolutely adamant that the vision of Christ is the only way to awaken from this nightmare. It's not about protecting all these energy bodies. It is about having this vision of that which cannot suffer loss. And from that standpoint, then, when that is anchored here in the distance, this vision, then this whole brutality has to pass that over, turn away from it, because it's terrified, it runs from it, because it cannot stand the idea of no loss. It's like kryptonite to it. It rejects it, denies it totally, and has to move away from it, has to pass it over, which I call the Passover principle. So what it really saves us here is the Passover principle, the anchoring of that which cannot suffer loss. The vision of that here in this world literally will brings about this whole dynamic of extreme brutality, of trying to annihilate all energy bodies, has to flee from that. Cannot touch it. Cannot do anything to it. Unconditional love cannot be touched. So what you do is you replace your energy bodies with this unconditional love. You allow unconditional love to flow through what you believe to be your energy bodies, to permeate it, as it were. And then what you see as energy bodies cannot be harmed. So even though it is symbolic, the energy bodies are symbolic, this symbolism has been overlaid as it were, overlaid by unconditional love, which means that this brutality must pass you by, which is why I have placed so much great emphasis on those who have anchored that here in this world. It's all important because it's an example to us of what we can do and must do. Those like Jesus Christ, Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Maima, those like that, those are examples, three examples, who had this unconditional love, this vision of unconditional love here in this world, and showing us that we too can do this. And we must do it if we are to escape this brutality which is coming upon this world. I had a dream last night of how it's going to happen, and it's terrible. It is really brutal. It's like a gang rape, really. It's something that terrible, where the world will be gang raped by this brutality, to try and destroy our energy bodies, try and annihilate them. So they're not after the physical; they're after the subtle energy bodies, the etheric energy body, the emotional energy body, the mental energy body, the causal energy body. They're trying to find a way to destroy these energy bodies, which can be done, because they're all symbolic. So symbols can destroy other symbols, definitely. It's all a play of abduction. It's all a play of imagination. So anything in imagination can take place. Just it's all equally unreal, though. It has no effect on reality. When you hear people say anything is possible, what they mean is in imagination, it's possible to destroy any symbols can be destroyed in imagination. It just has no real effect. It has no effect on reality at all. So really, this brutality is being set up in this world. I saw very clearly how it's being done. I played along with it. I've just been playing along to see what's going on here. And we get led into it by all these false promises that seem to be so wonderful. Instead of focusing on the vision of Christ, we are focusing on spirituality, thinking that this will protect us. Well, it will not. That's the sugarcoating that's been taking place. So the world thinks it's protected, and it's not. We are not. Only unconditional love protects us. The defenselessness of unconditional love, everything, again, is equally distributed everywhere, always. So what? There's no unfairness in unconditional love. There's no guilt in unconditional love. There's nothing to leverage into guilt or anything like that. And there's no purpose that it ever change. So that is stable. There cannot suffer loss. So brutality has to turn away from it and look elsewhere. That is the blood of Christ. Unconditional love is the blood of Christ. And being saved by the blood of Christ means being saved by this vision of unconditional love. That's what it actually means. So spiritual teaching on this planet needs to have that focus. And instead, we're being hoodwinked with this love and light teachings that are not on point. We think we're having these teachings of light, but it's just a hood. It's blinding us to what's really taking place. And I, you know, am able to see past this hoodwinking. To a certain extent, to the extent that I can see behind the scenes this brutality that has been planned and that is being implemented here. And we are literally being strapped down. The world is being tied down. And all the while we think, oh, we're advancing spiritually. You know, we're advancing the consciousness of the planet. We're blah, blah, blah. We're advancing all these energy bodies. We're evolving. That's all hoodwinking. Okay. This whole thing about spiritual evolution is a hoodwinking. The remedy is the vision of Christ, the blood of Christ, the vision of Christ, vision of oneness. That which cannot suffer any loss at all. That is the only protection we truly have. Everything else is a scam. We're being hoodwinked in this world by all of the love and light teachings, the spiritual teachings that seem to be so full of light and wonder. And it's all energy based. Anything that is energy based is hoodwinking. You're being hoodwinked, meaning you think what you're doing is going to be for your benefit, and you agree then to be strapped down and tied down and bound to energy, thinking that it's going to be wonderful. And then suddenly the brutality that energy brings upon itself, you'll be hit with it and will suffer this devastation of your energy bodies, which again is simply symbolizing what you are. But because you are using perception and belief in loss, you will believe you are losing your identity. You're losing yourself. You believe that what you are is being destroyed. You will believe it. It's not true, it's only symbolic, but you'll believe it, so it will seem horrible. This is what I see, this is what I'm aware of, what I've observed. I've put myself into this world in order to observe what's taking place here, and to see what's going on. And that is what is going on. It is really nasty. And again, there's only one way to protect yourself from it. This vision of Christ. Being willing for that. And you know, it's we're getting close to that point. Really, really close to the point where the brutality will begin. And we, you know, what's happening in the world is many people are sensing the brutality that is to come, and they're crying out against it, you know. The internet is full of it. The whole world is full of people sounding alarm bells, right? In many different angles, they say, oh my gosh, look what's happening. These draconian laws, these draconian decrees, these draconian activism in so many different ways, all these things, they say, we feel like we're being tied down. We feel like we're being, you know, herded into a cage. We feel, and yeah, the alarm bells are being sounded all over, and all of that is true. Because people intuitively sense, wait a minute, you know, why are you, you know, why is this, why are we being forced into this ideology? Why are we being forced into this guilt? Why are we being called terrible names? And it's this insane, tremendous pressure that has been brought to bear to tie us down so that then the brutality can have its way with us and we feel helpless to do anything about it. These guilt complexes that are being utilized now. The way our mind, the way our beliefs are being manipulated right now. All of that is a setup for the brutality that is to come. All of it. And so there's a few voices in this world that are speaking the truth. And that is, again, reject anything that is energy based. Okay, very simple. Any spiritual teaching that's based on energy, reject it. It's not it. It's not true. It's a setup. Unconditional love, it's not really an energy. It may seem to be. It's not, because it already equally overlays everything, equally distributed from the very beginning. So it's never been any movement, never been any change. So how can we call it energy? There's no loss taking place. Energy is all about, you know, change, right? There's no change taking place. Clothe yourself in the vision of Christ. Ancient times they called it the blood of Christ, okay? And me, I've never liked that because it's archaic. But you must understand that the ancient ones saw blood as literally being perception, as containing all attitudes, all attributes, all perception. They didn't, you know, the body to them was nothing. It was the blood that was all important. So when they say the blood of Christ, meaning the attributes, the perception of Christ means the perception of unconditional love. Christ means seamlessness, perfect distribution, equal distribution, unchanging, seamless peace and tranquility, which is unconditional love. So the blood of Christ means the vision of unconditional love. That's what it actually means. And that is the only way you can be saved from loss. And loss must pass you by. Those who have the vision of Christ, loss has to pass it by, because it sees nothing there. Not only does it see nothing there, it senses total threat to it, total threat that it cannot deal with in any way. And so it flees. It absolutely flees from the vision of Christ. It flees from it as fast as possible in terror. Leaves it alone entirely. So this unconditional love, loss has fled from it and has left an entire realm untouched by loss. This completely immaculate realm is there. So those with a vision of Christ, not only will they be untouched by the brutality that will take place on this planet, it will literally find itself in a paradise untouched by loss, an immaculate paradise. That's why Jesus said on the cross to the one on his right side ever, saying, you will be with me this very day in paradise, in the immaculate like realm, untouched by loss, because you accepted the fate. You saw through the, you realized at the last moment before you passed away, you realized, aha, I see what's going on. The one thief saw it, the other one didn't. The other did not see that. And continued on with suffering, you know, brutality. Suffer the brutality of it. So we're digging into this, and it's very, very important to dig into it. Because, again, the alarm bells, I'm sure that those who are watching this video have felt those alarm bells go off. The red flags, no question. You can hardly live in this world without experiencing these red flags. It takes an enormous effort to be unaware of them. You have to be focused on television and movies and gossip all the time in order to not kind of be unaware of it. Stick your head in the sand entirely, which is all the gloss. All those people who are putting this sugarcoating at all, they're literally part of this brutality. They're the ones who do the song and dance that tie us down and make and hoodwink us so that we feel bound and unable to escape. They're the ones that lead us on. So really we think that the ones who brutalize us are the wicked ones, but really the ones who set it all up are equally wicked. Existence is entirely wicked. Okay, entirely. Both the good and the bad are equally wicked. It's all wickedness. Loss has to, before brutality, the brutality of trying to destroy energy bodies does its dance, there still has, first there has to be a dance of building it all up, building stuff up to and then sugarcoating it all and deceit, blinding everyone to what the brutality that is coming, which is done by the song and dance here of hey, aren't we having fun? Isn't this all great? All the frivolity, all the glitz and the glamour and the frivolity, misdirection, all of that is intentionally done to set ourselves up so that then we can be, our energy bodies can be brutalized. It's very important, again, to emphasize the energy bodies are not us, have nothing to do with us. It's a way we symbolize what we are. It's a way that we symbolize. We don't have a soul. A soul is just a belief. Spirit does not have a soul. We are spirit. We're immaculate. We don't need any soul. We are spirit. We directly experience the essence of reality and the flow of that essence in infinite multidimensional ways. We already are that. From the very beginning, we were created as that. And we haven't changed in the slightest bit. When we tried to imagine we could be something different, greater than what we are, something different, then the belief in a soul arose from that, and the belief that the soul is on a journey, and then we wrap the soul up in these energy bodies to participate in this journey through this energy-based dream. But we really did it for us so that we could believe that it's possible to suffer loss. That the so-called soul, losing all its energy bodies, would be annihilated. See, we symbolize the idea of that which is holding an idea so that we could believe that that which holds an idea can be annihilated. So the soul is just a symbol of spirit, the one that chooses and holds an idea. And then these energy bodies are clothing the supposed soul, are the wave of experiencing imaginary effects, so that when these energy bodies are destroyed, we believe that the soul will be destroyed also, and this will be the symbols of the destruction of spirit. But there really is no such thing as a soul. There's no real thing. It's our imagination. It's the way spirit is imagining that there is a soul, and then it imagines that this soul is experiencing through all these energy bodies, and then it destroys all these energy bodies, and it believes then that this imaginary soul must also be destroyed. But what happens is you simply are left with this experience of endless chaos, and I've experienced that. And yet I remained. I wasn't annihilated. What I am was not annihilated at all. It just jumped back and said, this experience is total chaos. I don't want that. That's all that happened. I didn't experience any loss of soul. I mean, symbolically I did. I thought I lost my soul, and then I realized that that too was symbolic. The soul is symbolic. The whole dream of a soul on a pilgrimage of evolution and of growth and development, that is all being imagined by spirit. All of it. There's no real meaning to it whatsoever, no truth to it whatsoever. Spirit, I didn't create spirit to go on some imaginary journey through this vast scenario of loss. Spirit chose that because spirit wanted to be greater than God, more than reality. Wanted to change what it was, so it has to dream this dream of loss, of annihilation. It's trying to annihilate itself, trying to annihilate reality. And so it brings up this soul that is on this, you know, and the sugar candy coats it, oh, the soul's on this great journey, blah, blah, blah. That just hides the fact that it's just a setup, and that it's trying to collapse, destroy these energy bodies, which would leave the soul without any means to experience whatsoever, which would symbolic would mean that the soul is nothing. It's annihilated. It's all imaginary. And you can suffer the loss of all your energy bodies and the soul, which I did. And I thought I was annihilated, but I was still experiencing that which is experiencing the annihilation. I was still there. I was still entirely there. At the same time, I thought I was completely annihilated. But I experienced this annihilation as total chaos. Endless total chaos with no reference point to stop it, to organize whatsoever. And yet what I was, what I am experiencing this was seamless. So I said, well, you know, and there was no soul, there was no energy bodies, there was nothing but this chaos. That's all that I was left with. So I literally experienced that, been through all that, and what I was still flawlessly experiencing this. And I said, well, okay, there's something completely bogus about this whole thing. Totally bogus. So that's why I'm here now telling you, anything that talks about a soul, anything that talks about energy, energy body, all of this is bogus. It's not the truth. It's a setup. Real spiritual talk talks about spirit, talks about truth, talks about unconditional love, talks about the vision of that unconditional love as the only remedy there is. That's why Jesus said there's only one way, so to speak, only one way to be saved from this. That is the vision of Christ. That's the only way. All this talk about energy and evolution and the soul and advancing the soul and the soul learning about unconditional love, soul, this, there is no soul. There is no soul, no such thing. I experienced the annihilation of the soul, everything, and still, what I am, still remain untouched. My awareness of it remained untouched. My experiencing of it was untouched. So I said, well, this is all like a dream. It's like the dream ends, as it were, in total chaos, and yet the dreamer of the dream remains. I still remain. I said, whoa. Wow. I thought, I believed I was nothing, and yet I was still completely aware of this nothing. You see? And then I said, okay, well, what's the remedy for this? What's the remedy? And reason told me it's unconditional love, experiencing that, which can only be seen through vision, not through perception. So, again, I emphasize over and over the hoodwinking that sets us up to be brutalized. That's when I say us, I mean our energy bodies, okay? Which is not really us, but we think it is. So we're really headed towards just this incredible suffering. And those in this world now are setting it all up. From the top to the bottom. Many different ways. The so-called spirituality, there are many who claim to be very spiritual who are just setting up this hoodwinking. Politically, we're all being set up politically. Through laws, legally, we're all being set up legally. We're being bound legally. We're being bound politically, legally, socially, culturally, spiritually. In every way, we're being bound right now. Our energy bodies, our belief system is being bound so that we can be brutalized and these energy bodies be destroyed. That is literally the situation that we're in. And yet there is an escape from it. Absolutely is an escape from it. Vision of Christ. Automatically you will be passed by all of this. They will just say that you don't exist, that there's nothing there, that the notion of brutalizing you will be an absurdity to them, because they say, well, there's nothing there to brutalize. Next, you know, like that. And, you know, we're at the point where I know some of you are registering what's being said here, because it's time to take off the gloves. You know, it's time to stop fooling around here, because we're almost tied down to the point where we will feel too hopeless and helpless. That's what I've seen, that it's like we've put ourselves in the noose. Like our hands and our feet and everything are in nooses that are about to be tightened. And we've put ourselves in there, and we still have a little bit of mobility, you know. But at any moment it could be tightened, like zip ties, you know, on our hands and feet, so that we feel we can't even move at all. We're very close to that point, extremely close to it. And that's why these cultural wars are happening, all these battles, where people are saying, no, wait a minute, we don't want to be tied down. You say, wait, what's going on here? Why are you trying to, you know, tie me down? You know, so it's kind of like cattle when they're being herded into cattle cars. They know something's wrong. They're saying, well, wait a minute. I don't want to leave this pasture. What are you doing? And yet they're too dull to really know what to do about it. You know, they're animalistic. Anything that binds us to energy binds us to animalistic, the animal, as it were, instead of spirit, instead of real spirit. And we therefore don't listen to reason. Reason tells us the remedy. Whereas the animal nature, as it were, doesn't turn to reason. It turns to more energy. Some kind of energy solution. Anything that has turned to some sort of energy solution will only make things worse for you. Whatever it is, no matter how much spiritual gloss is put on it, no matter how much makeup is put on it, it still is only going to bind you to brutality. And in any energy-based solution, no matter how it's spiritualized, it's only binding you. It's hoodwinking you. It's like putting a blindfold on you that's white instead of black, and saying, oh, you know, look how white the blindfold is. And you think, yeah, I'm not blindfolded. I've got this white, white cloth wrapped around my eyes. I can't see, but it's white. It's not a black blindfold. And gee, it must be okay, right? And yet you still can't see anything. It's not okay. So the vision of unconditional love is the remedy. And we're talking about it directly here because we are so close to being bound down severely. I can feel it myself. Red flags are just everywhere. It is a red flag situation. Beyond what we can hardly entertain as far as looking at it, I mean. Again, I looked at it, I'm looking at it progressively, seeing it, and it is brutality. It's beyond what we think. It's not, we think like, oh, you know, we're all going to be herded into camps and killed or something. No, it's worse than that, way worse. It's a plan of brutality, brutalized, where, again, our subtle bodies, all energy bodies, will be brutalized and turned in chaotic. It's an attempt to bring about total chaos within our subtle bodies. Your physical body may still be alive, Okay? That's not the goal. The goal is not so much to destroy physical bodies. That may be part of it, to terrorize everyone here. But the real goal is to bring chaos into these subtle bodies. Bring about just complete destruction into total chaos of these subtle bodies. And the physical stage here of all this physicality is used to bring that about. We see all the sickness. The body is heir to endless sickness and suffering, okay? And in perceiving this, the physical realm is where the subtle bodies, the perceiving that these subtle bodies take, undergo, and experiencing of this physical realm, of this dense physical realm, that is how these subtle bodies are brought into chaos. They're not brought into chaos on their at their own level. It's only at this the level of this gross, dense, physical energy play that can bring about the disintegration of these subtle bodies. Okay, that is why this physical density here, and it's why the focus is on this physical density. It's on this planet Earth right now. There's 7 billion bodies that can be utilized to disintegrate the subtle bodies. That is the plan. That is literally the plan that is far advanced and ready to take place. That is why it is said in the Bible, like the book of Revelations, where it says that all this pouring out of affliction upon the world, all these vials are poured out of severe affliction. And there's just this massive wave after wave after wave, tsunamis of affliction upon the physical plane. That is being done to bring about disintegration of the subtle planes. Subtle planes. And of course, those on the subtle planes saying, "We must stop this. This cannot happen. We don't want the subtle planes to suffer this disintegration." But even those are deluded, because the subtle planes themselves are imaginary. Imaginary. So the way to safety, again, is the Passover principle. It is not to fight and struggle against, on the physical plane, against this disintegration and all this stuff. Because that is still using energy, engaging yourself energetically. Still belief in a soul. See, even the causal levels believes in a soul. All these energy levels, these subtle levels, believe in a soul, and they want to keep their levels beautiful, and pure and highly integrated. And so they're terrified of what's happening here on Earth now. Terrified it's going to disintegrate their energy levels, which is true. It will. They think they're protecting the soul, and they don't realize there is no soul. That too is imaginary. The entire realm of energy is imaginary. From the gross to the most subtle, it's all a play of spirit's imagination. It has no reality, no meaning to it whatsoever. Any meaning that's given to it is just imaginary meaning. So there are plenty of those in the world who are desperately trying to prevent this from taking place, because they fear, rightfully so, that their realms are going to be disintegrated. But the real teaching of safety is, again, the vision of Christ. That is where true safety can be found. And the vision of Christ does not oppose anything. It's defenseless, because it knows it doesn't need any defense. But those on the causal levels, there are many here, many energy bodies and focuses of perception from the causal, from the mental, from the emotional, from the etheric, interacting with this world at this time, desperately trying to stop this brutality from taking place on the physical level here, because they know it's going to cause them severe troubles on their levels of energy. They know that, and they're terrified of it. And they say, "Well, why don't you help out? Why do you help out?" Because I know that is not the answer. That it will only bring about, it will not bring about the result they hope for. That is for sure. Maybe they can do something, you know, to lessen the brutality. I don't know exactly. But it only reinforces delusion. Resistance only reinforces delusion because they think they're protecting something that isn't real in the first place. They're protecting the evolution of the soul, which they think gives rise to these higher levels, these subtle levels of energy, which are beautiful domains, etc., beautiful realms. And they think that they can remain in those realms forever and that this is their home. And yet always they're vulnerable to this end play, which an end run by this brutality at the denser levels, which is what they're experiencing now. They call it the devil, Lucifer, this diabolical plot to make an end run around these higher realms and destroy them. Not seeing that this is actually the entire purpose of existence in the first place, and that they're just patsies. These higher realms are just patsies for this end run. Just to prove, as it were, that an end run around reality is possible, an end run around spirit is possible. Again, this soul is just an imaginary substitute for spirit. And then this end run that is taking place is simply proving that, as it were, that an end run around spirit and around reality is possible, even though it's not at all. So it's all just a setup. It's all a setup. That's what I've seen. I've seen through it. So which is why I am emphasizing the vision of Christ is the only protection there really is, and it's a total protection. It's the only remedy there really is. It's a total remedy. It's not just going into these subtle levels, the causal level, of these energy levels of subtle energy, and protecting those energies from end runs. Because I tell you for sure that end runs will always take place. They will always be possible. And literally, you'll have to be eternally vigilant in existence, constantly struggling against what you see as our diabolical plots to disintegrate your level of energy wherever you're at. Always. You'll never be free of that. You'll always feel vulnerable. No matter where you are in existence, you will always feel vulnerability. Because you will be vulnerable. Because these end runs ceaselessly take place. Ceaselessly take place. Always there's this somehow they, no matter how much they seem to be vanquished, they always regroup and taking place. Always. But in unconditional love, there's no end run whatsoever. None. There's no vulnerability to that whatsoever. So I keep speaking out on this for those who are receptive to it, who can hear it and consider it and say, you know, I always knew that there was something wrong. And, it's not easy to hear this because we are so conditioned to think that the subtle realms of energy are somehow salvation. And there we dwell in the presence of the soul, as it were. And we're free and we're safe, etc. It's not true. And we start feeling this threat. The people, those that dwell in the subtle realms, are coming here in this world saying, hey, this is a terrible threat here. You guys better stop at what you're doing here because you're threatening our realm. And we're very upset about that. So they literally, there's this great feeling of vulnerability in the higher realms of energy. Terrible feeling of threat here. You know, they say, you've got to stop your nuclear program. You're really threatening our existence, et cetera, et cetera. So they're not invulnerable. These subtle realms are not invulnerable at all, which means they're not real. What is real can never be threatened in any way. So the bliss, so-called blissful, peaceful experiencing of these subtle levels of energy, you know, that only lasts for a certain while, and then everyone there is called to defense, to defend this blissfulness, this so-called energetic blissfulness. They realize, oh my gosh, this is being threatened. We must go down to these grosser levels and stop it. And so you leave these subtle levels and you descend through the grosser levels, energy levels, and you find yourself here in this world and desperately, you know, struggling to prevent the problems, or you find yourself channeling through somebody here in this world, desperately trying to get them to stop the problems, you know, bring about, you know, peace here in this world, you know. Hey, and yet those whose purpose is to brutalize, they have their marching orders too. And they're very expert at what they do. They're very clever at what they do. And you know, they eat these energy levels for lunch. They eat them up. They destroy them. Because, again, the purpose of existence is to destroy itself. So that's what happens. And dwelling on these causal levels, they realize, oh my gosh, we don't have the power we thought we did. And so we need to, again, to evolve more so we can prevent this in the future, not realizing that the very purpose of existence is to be vulnerable to its own destruction. So you're never going to feel safety in existence, in energy. Never. Never, never, never. And eventually you see this, and then you say, oh my gosh, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And then reason shows up and says, hey, there's a remedy. Don't worry. Don't worry. Vision of Christ is the remedy. Unconditional love, seeing that, perceiving it, is the remedy. The nightmare's over. So I've been fortunate to be in this position because I've gone through all this, coming from the higher realms, the causal realm, where I was in this energetic bliss, and then feeling this threat to this realm, and then saying, oh my gosh, I've got to help save this realm, and then taking incarnation into this world, and then suffering through the destruction of all energy bodies, and seeing that it's the total chaos. I said, how do I protect it? I needed to see what's going on. So when I saw what's going on, I realized, whoa, you know, everything's destroyed, and yet I still remain. So the soul cannot be really what I am. And then I began to listen to reason, and the whole situation became clarified for me. Eventually, it's taken a lot of work, because it's not easy for those who dwell in the higher, you know, realms of a very beautiful, blissful, energetically blissful, seemingly, you know, tranquil realms. You know, they don't want to leave those realms. They want to just stay there, you know, for good. And yet they end up having to defend these realms. So they're not happy. They don't want to, you know, they think they have it all figured out. They hope they do. They insist they do. But I found out that no, they're completely deluded. Completely deluded. And that's not easy to realize. Because then you think you're never going to get back to those energetically blissful realms. But what I've seen is now that, no, you get something infinitely better, which is this unconditional love. It's infinitely better than any realm of energy whatsoever, which is all intrinsically totally vulnerable to disintegration and total chaos. So paradoxically, by going through this disintegration and suffering this total chaos, one realizes that, hey, I still remain. There's something that is untouched by all this. And then they say, wow, what's going on? And then reason shows up. It's always there, but then they turn to reason and say, I demand an explanation for this. That's what happened. I said, I'm entitled to an explanation. I demand it. And then reason said, oh, great. Here I am. I'll explain it to you. And it has. It's explained it to me through and through. That's what happens. So, it's inescapable in existence to go through sufferings and eventually be brought to this state of disintegration. It's inevitable. Now, there are ways that you can go through it quickly and come out the other end, as it were, and start listening to reason and go quickly like I did. Still, the suffering is terrible. No doubt about it, terrible. And perhaps there are gentler ways, but the overall situation remains the same. And at some point, you have to hook up with reason. Which explains the whole situation to you, the entirety of it. Which is why these videos might escape some, the relevance may escape them, because I'm talking about the entirety of the situation. Again, there is no such thing as a soul, there is no energy, it's just symbolic. There is no remedy at the level of energy whatsoever. The vision of unconditional love, the perception of that, again, cannot be perceived by the senses of the body, which can only perceive loss. It's the only way to be safe from this scenario we've imagined, the only way to be safe from it. And it's certainly possible that there are some that will accept the vision of Christ at this time. There's always been some throughout history, because brutality has been going on this planet nonstop. Nonstop. If you look at history, you know it's the history of brutality. This planet has simply been the play of brutality. Different groups go through it at different times. But right now, it's meant that the entire planet goes through this brutality to use this as a means of trying to brutalize the subtler realms of energy. And certainly they will be brutalized, there's no question about it. And they're, you know, these causal, subtle levels of energy are trying to prevent this, trying to enlist, you know, help to prevent it. Once again, that is not the correct path, because it only reinforces delusion. Because at the causal level, at these levels, it's all about simply believing that this is home. That's all it's about. That's what everyone reinforces. Yeah, this is it, this is it, this is it. When in fact it's not it. So the spiritual path, the voice of reason is not listened to there. Because everyone there is simply trying to say, yeah, this is it, we're home. When in fact it's not home at all. It's generally only when you come down into the denser realms and experience the brutality there and what's going on here that you turn to the voice of reason, and then the voice of reason clarifies the entire situation. Because those in the subtler realms do not want to listen, do not want to hear that where they're at is not where it's really at all. They don't want to hear it. Do not want to hear it. But here at this level where we're really suffering, where we're feeling this brutality, this wave of brutality, the jackboots of brutality here, that we say, whoa, wait a minute, you know, that this could really mess up the causal realm too, and it looks like it will, then we say, holy cow, that causal realm is not our home at all. And then we turn to reason, saying, where is our home? And then reason clarifies the whole situation for us. So it's really a blessing to be here in the world at this time. It's a double-edged sword. It can be either a curse or a blessing, you know, but it can really be the greatest blessing. My teacher, Sri Anandamaya Ma, said, suffering removes suffering. That suffering is the greatest blessing. Jesus said the same thing. Blessed are the meek, those who suffer, the poor in spirit, because they then can say, wow, wait a minute. You know, the causal realms, the subtle realms are not stable. They're not invulnerable. They're not my home. They're not what I really want. And then they say, okay, you know, I need to know how do I get what I really want? And then reason comes into the picture. Divine reason, as it were, comes into the picture and explains it all. So it's a blessing to have it all explained, have it all clarified. It's a great blessing. So suffering removes suffering, as it were, through the agency of reason, clarification, of saying, oh, I don't want that. Realizing that all of existence is suffering. Not when we say all of existence, we don't mean just this gross level of energy here. We mean all of existence, all levels, subtle and gross, the entirety of it, the entire play of energies is only suffering. That's all that it is. And at some point, one has to see that and realize it, and accept it, and say, "Ah, I don't want any of it." So I'm not aiming towards the causal level or some subtle energy level at all. I'm aiming towards the loss-free experience. The realm, paradise realm, as it were. That's my aim, and it's not the causal level at all. It's genuine bliss, effortless bliss, eternal delight, with no worry or fear of defensiveness at all, no need for any defensiveness. That's really, that is the goal, that is the aim. Not to just keep shoring up these levels of energy, various levels of energy, defending them somehow. That's not it. It's not it, it's not it, it's not it, it's not it. And so you can just, you know, take this in, listen to it, take it in. And maybe something within you will hear it, or you say, yeah. A reason will say, yeah, 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 yeah. That's it. Reason will say, see, it's possible to listen to reason. It is possible. Reason will say, see, I can clarify it for you. I can clarify the entire picture for you, even while you're here in this world, in the gross level, okay? You see, reason can clarify it anywhere you are. I was literally, my energy bodies were literally destroyed. And yet I remain. My soul was destroyed. Everything was destroyed. I felt I was beyond death. I mean, my physical body remained. But the energy, subtle energy bodies, all of them were destroyed. I felt nothing. I felt annihilation. Total chaos of my soul, my mind, my emotions, everything totally destroyed. And yet I remained. And yet the voice of reason reached me clearly. So no matter where you are in your play with energy, the voice of reason can reach you clearly. Anywhere. Anywhere. No matter how bad your suffering, it can reach you. No matter what state of destruction you feel, you think you believe yourself to be in, it can reach you. Even if you believe that you're totally annihilated, it can reach you. Because what you are cannot be annihilated at all, cannot even be touched by any loss. And so what you are is still aware of this total annihilation, and reason will introduce itself and say, hello, guess what? This is all bogus. It's all a dream. And I will clarify and I will explain it all to you. And then you listen and say, oh, good, 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 good. And reason will say, Spirit, I'm talking to you because you are believing in all this. But really, I'm just your humble servant explaining this to you. Reason is the humble servant of Spirit, explaining to Spirit how, you know, what's what, really. Because Spirit is believing that all this is true and that somehow it's been annihilated. And reason will say, Spirit, how can you be annihilated when you are the one that's experiencing all of this? You see? It's not possible, is it? So no matter where you are, no matter how bad your situation is, reason can and will reach you if you turn to it and say, you know what? I really want an explanation for this. I want, you know, all this explained. How is this possible? And, you know, again, I advise those who are talking about the soul, any energy-based thing, no matter how spiritual it seems, forget about it. Listen to reason. Let reason explain the entirety of the situation to you, because that's all you need. You don't need any energy solution whatsoever. You don't need any energy solution. You don't need any soul solution at all. You don't need any process, no evolution. You need the entirety of the situation to be explained to you. That is what you really need. You need the whole thing, the entirety of it. And reason has done that for me. Reason has done that for my spirit. My spirit says, yes, reason, you've done your job. You've explained. Not be, you know, crystal clear, but I've painted the landscape, you've painted the picture, you've painted the outline of it all, and that's all that's really needed. You know, I may get a little foggy from time to time, you know, because you know we've been in a fog, in a daze for so long, as it were, identifying with existence, believing existence is real, that it's, you know, the awakening, we're a little groggy for sure, that's okay. But I say, my testimony is that reason has explained the totality of the situation perfectly well, has painted the picture. I'm satisfied with what reason has done. It's sufficient, absolutely sufficient. Clarified it all from the top to bottom, showing me, yeah, all this was, you know, my own imagination. The soul, the energy bodies, the evolution, this idea that the soul is developing. It's all like that, the notion that this is all God's plan to develop the soul. I imagine all of that. Spirit's imagining all of that. That's just a cover. We will keep constructing, be positively constructive, so that there then something can suffer loss. Without continually imagining constructivity, all these constructs, what meaning would loss even symbolically have? It wouldn't even have any symbolic meaning. There wouldn't be anything to lose. So of course we have to imagine that this is all has some grand purpose other than loss. And so it's like our minds are split, as it were, between constructivity and destructivity. One hand doesn't know what the other hand is doing, as it were. It's all coming from one source. Spirit is imagining all this scenario of loss. The key to it is to realize that in order for loss to even have a symbolic meaning, there has to be symbolic constructs that symbolize life, symbolize value, symbolize something that we don't want to lose. And then that then ends up suffering loss, and then it seems as though then loss has some power, some meaning, it's got some capability to it. So we have to tell the story, oh yes, we're a soul, we are journeying through this all that is here, and we are learning all these valuable lessons, and we're gaining all these valuable attributes, and we're literally creating this soul to be eventually one with God, etc. We tell it ourselves. We've invented this story just so we can be cannon fodder for loss. So then all of us can be brutalized. Literally. That is what we're doing. We set up all these imaginary realms, no matter how beautiful they are, so they can be brutalized at some point and brought to utter chaos. So that we can believe that the soul also has been destroyed. So that we can believe that we, spirit, have the capability to transcend what we are and create ourselves anew. We have some idea to establish a new identity for ourselves. And the only way we could imagine this possible is we have to get rid of the identity that we are. We have to annihilate it somehow. So we imagine this whole scenario. It's very clear. Reason has made it clear now to this spirit, this aspect of spirit. This very day, it's all very clear. It's been clear for a long time, but not at the level of being able to speak about it. Because there's a massive intimidation here not to say any of this stuff. Because the agents of brutality, you know, they don't want their quarry to escape. But, you know, I'm obligated, responsible to say yes, but reason has done its job, it's clarified it. Even to the point where I can even speak about it here on this extreme density and extreme area of extreme growing darkness, meaning the jackboots of brutality are marching through along the streets. They're in the streets marching now. They're identifying their targets. All of that is taking place. Seems subtle to us right now, but it's actually very blatant. And the brutality to come here is off the scale of what most people are assuming, off the scale. Not to frighten anybody, but again, I say reason absolutely can clarify the totality of a situation that you are trapped, think you're trapped in. And you will not feel a sense of regret. I don't feel any regret of having this clarified. I don't feel I've been robbed of anything. By seeing that this is all a dream, there is no soul, these causal realms are all vulnerable, there is no home there, I don't feel robbed of anything, or dispossessed of anything, or impoverished. I'm not upset at reason for showing me this. I'm not. I have not yet received the vision of Christ, but I know it'll come. But even without that vision, I'm not upset. I don't feel angry towards reason at all. I feel grateful, very grateful, wonderful, wonderful. I don't feel an increased sense of vulnerability. I feel a decreased sense of vulnerability. Because I say, reason, you have finally, you've done it. You did it. What you promised me you would do, you kept your promise. Unlike the ego that never keeps its promise. Reason promised me when I was at this low point of all my energy bodies and my soul were annihilated and I experienced nothing but total chaos. I said, my gosh, will be my experience now forever. And I said, I said, you know, there's something screwy about this because the experiencer of this is still untouched. So what's going on? Can this be explained? And then the voice of reason said, yes. And said, I will explain all of it to you. And I won't leave you. I won't leave you. And I will experience all of it, clarify all of it to you. And then I will stay with you with that clarity. And I said, wow, really? Can you really do this? You're making a big promise. And reason said, yes, I promise I'll do that. Reason kept his promise. Kept his promise. It clarified everything for me. And still remains with me. Hasn't left me. It's not like it clarifies everything and says, okay, I'm going to leave you now. No, it's still here. Still here. So I'm telling you for sure, you can trust reason. You can trust it. When reason promises you that it will stay with you and clarify everything, the totality of the situation. Not the details aren't important, right? It's the seeing the simple totality of what the situation really is. That's all that counts. And reason will do that. It will keep its promise. It absolutely will keep its promise. So don't let existence intimidate you. What you are cannot be touched by any brutality, by any loss whatsoever. And reason will lead you out of this nightmare. Clarify it, and you will not be angry at reason. You will not hate it. You will not get to a point where, you will not ever come to the point where you hate reason. You might be, you know, it might cause you might get kind of irritated or worried. You're like, wow, I don't know. But no, I have zero hatred, zero irritation. There's no upset towards reason whatsoever. It absolutely did what it promised it would do. And it laid bare the whole situation. And reason does see truly this whole situation, sees it truly, and it shares that true seeing with us. It shared it with me. Didn't try to hold anything back. It's not like trying to be greater than me or try to hold something back so I remain deluded. No way. Shared everything. Sharing everything. Shared all the way to, you know, the total truth, the complete, total picture of the situation. Pointing out the entirety of the picture. That's what reason wants to do. At first, we're focused on like a little detail here, little detail there. Reason always sees the total picture, sees all of it, the totality of it. And what it tries to do is it gradually leads us so we stop focusing on these little trivial details and we look at the totality of the situation, the totality of the picture, instead of the frame around it, as it were. And then we see, I see what the picture really is. I was distracted by the frame. I'm looking at the details of the frame instead of just looking at the picture. Reason says, just look at the picture, don't worry. Don't worry. There's a remedy for all this, don't worry. And so I've just, you know, looked at the totality of the picture, saying, ah, yes, I see. It does really fit. That's exactly what has happened. And so what happens is you say, aha, now I see why I've been put through all the suffering and misery and why everything, you know, I went through everything I went through. Now I see why. Ah, wow. And now I realize I don't have to do that anymore. It's just simply, it was just a futile waste of time, futile, based on a false premise. So, you know, I don't have to do it anymore. So I'm happy to be freed from doing what doesn't work. I don't have to do what doesn't work anymore. I don't have to go through these cycles of dying at the gross level, dying at the subtle level, dying and going up to the subtlest level, and then having to eventually cycle back down through all the levels until I find myself again in the gross level to defend the soul, as it were, from vulnerability. Don't have to do that anymore. Don't have to do it anymore. Freed from all of that. And reason showed me the whole picture. So thank you, reason. And I know reason will stay with me. It's not going to say, oh, I did my job. Okay, see you later. No. Still here. Thank you, reason. So I'm just a witness to this here in this world, just a witness, which is what the world needs. It needs witnesses to reason, because reason is something that can be shared with even with your belief system and with your faith. It speaks your language. The vision of Christ is beyond reason, and so it really cannot be shared the same way that reason can share. Reason can sit and talk with anyone, whereas the vision of Christ is a direct experiencing of unconditional love, which intellect cannot relate to it. The energy bodies cannot relate to that, but the energy bodies can relate to reason very well. It speaks our language, uses words, uses symbols, uses concepts, it uses everything that we're imagining. It uses those and guides us to look at the picture and not the frame. Whereas unconditional love is beyond that. It overlays it all. And that's beyond the scope of perception and intellect, and all the energy bodies cannot relate to it, really. That's why I say reason remains. So that even with the vision of Christ, one is still able to use reason to relate to people. And can, you know, talk and explain and clarify. Still there, remains. Doesn't disappear. So again, it's very important to do this witnessing at this time, at any time, but this time is especially important. And there should be witnesses to this coming to the forefront now, because there have been many from the causal realm, high realms, come down into this dense world to try and protect the soul, and they probably have gone through enormous suffering, and they've probably been listening to reason as I have, and they're probably getting to the point now where they can come forth and say, hey, you know, this is, let me witness to reason and truth. It's quite likely. Quite likely. And even some who dwell in truth and reality may have come down here on this planet to help out at this time. Those who are not deluded at all. Which is, once you're freed from delusion, then it's very simple. You're not vulnerable to it again. There may even be some of those in this world at this time. I don't know where they are. So there may be quite a few here witnessing, who witnessed the truth at this time, but they better come out of the woodwork soon, because the brutality is about ready to begin. The nooses are about ready to tighten here, and it's not like that. It's not like they're not going to tighten. I am not saying that brutality is not going to happen. No, it certainly will happen, because again, purpose of existence is to annihilate itself, and therefore those who bring about the annihilation, the attempt annihilation, they have the upper hand. They're very clever. And, you know, the dismay that we're feeling in this world is the feeling like they do have the upper hand. And everybody's looking for a hero, you know. But when it comes to the play of energy, annihilation has the upper hand. So it's not possible for someone who believes in the soul and the play of energy, it's not possible for them to have the upper hand. They will find themselves losing ground, losing ground, losing ground, as if they're fighting a losing battle, which is what many feel in this world, that they're fighting a losing battle. And they will go into a, you know, they'll go into a cult-like shell. Let's everybody think positive thoughts, we can stop it if we just think positive thoughts, that kind of stuff. And that just ends up causing more fragmentation into energy and tribalism arising, you know, of everybody going into their little tribal shell, sticking their heads in the sand, as it were. It's not the remedy. Very bad. So, I mean, the brutality, it does have the upper hand. It's obvious. Which is why so many of us feeling this feeling of dismay. Dismay. It's like the good guys are losing, as it were. They're losing the battle. I look at it and say, how in the hell? Wow. It's terrible. Terrible. And yet I'm not willing to go into this narrow tribalistic outlook. You know, let's all just, you know, think positive thoughts or something. I say, that's not working. It's not working. I'm still observing what's going on. The, you know, to those whose role in existence it is to brutalize, they're not affected by this stuff. They don't even believe in it. They don't care. You know, they don't care about anything. They don't care about spirituality, as it were. They don't care about positive thoughts. They don't care about any of that stuff. They laugh at it, you know. They just, their job is to destroy all that. And we don't get, those who are based on, you know, trying to maintain these positive realms, these higher realms, you know, we're naive, totally naive. Naivete is not good. We keep thinking that we have the upper hand, you know, that this love and light and higher realms of energy have the upper hand. It's not true. We do not, that does not have the upper hand. I speak of we as if I were aligned with that, but really I'm not aligned with any of it. Like a neutral. I'm neutral to all of it. Because I see it's all part of one dynamic. That the naivete itself is part of this destructivity. The naivete of the higher subtle realms is part of the vulnerability. It's all part of it. So it's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. Naivete is not a good thing. It only serves the purpose of destructivity and brutality. That's all that it serves. It doesn't serve the purpose of truth at all. And so I see so many in this world are incredibly naive. They're spiritually naive. They're acting as if they're very spiritual, but they're incredibly naive. And that serves the purpose of brutality, very much so. Which is why I say, of course, brutality is going to have its way in this world. Because all this, these defenses are based on extreme naivete. Because they don't understand that defenselessness is the only defense there is. Of just dismissing, choosing a different purpose is the only defense there is. You cannot have the purpose of annihilating what you are and still feel invulnerable. It's not possible. So you'll have to get caught up in all sorts of schemes of defensiveness, schemes of defensiveness, all sorts of strategy. Yeah, we're gonna, you know, sprinkle fairy dust here and love and light here, and you know, everyone's caught up in this desperate sprinkling of fairy dust of trying to prevent this onslaught, and the onslaught just laughs at that and just says, ha. You know, that doesn't stop us. And then we say, wow, my gosh, we better sprinkle more, you know, hardcore fairy dust. You know, where can we get some stronger fairy dust? And it's naive. Naivete is not safety. What is safety is listening to the voice of reason, which explains the total situation to us. And then we realize there's nothing to fear from the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness. And then we're willing to have that bestowed upon us. That is safety. That's how it really works. As far as existence, we understand it's all an imaginary scenario of loss. It has nothing that we really want. Okay, let's make this clarification here. It seems to have everything we want, but it has nothing we really want. There's a big difference between thinking that we want and really wanting. If we're honest, we'll say existence has nothing that we really want, but it has all sorts of stuff we think we want, right? So we chase after rainbows constantly. Think that's got something we want. We think, oh, that looks like it might have something we want. I think it might have something that I want. Ask yourself, does it have that which I really want, that I really, really want? Because what we really want is to be freed of this nightmare of loss. What we really want is invulnerability. What we really want is eternal delight and bliss and carefreeness and freedom from fear. That's what we really want. And existence doesn't have that. Does not have that. And will never have it. So it has nothing that we really want. So whatever we're losing is not what we really want. It's just a deceptive form of loss. It's a pretty form of loss. It's a glossy, glamorous, sexy form of loss. You know, we think, maybe I think I might want that. No. All of that gloss, whatever form, is just deception to keep us playing with this this scenario of loss, so that we end up getting our energy bodies end up getting brutalized, and we think we suffer severe loss. That is why you're there. It's the sirens, the song of the sirens. Sirens lure the sailors to their destruction. It's that principle. You know, the sailors are looking at these beautiful sirens saying, wow, I really want that. Let's go in that direction. And they sail their ship right into right into the reef. Destroyed. They lose they lose their ship. They lose their life. They lose their food. They lose their destination. They lose everything. In other words, their energy bodies get destroyed, as it were. It's more than just their loss of life. It's, you know, they're devastated in many levels, energy levels, by this. All because these beautiful sirens showed up. They thought, oh, gosh, this is what we want. But if the sailors just said, wait a minute, is this what I really want? Really, really want? Or is it just what I think I want? Is it some energy body thinking that it wants this? Then the sailors would say, no. Those are just sirens luring us to our direction. And the world is full of this principle, the siren principle. I call it the goddess of destructivity principle, which is everywhere you look in this world, that siren principle is there extremely strongly on every street corner, as it were. I call it the horse of existence. There's this principle of keeping us, luring the energy bodies into pursuing and thinking there's something that it wants here. I say existence is horrible. Horeable. Horrible. Meaning that we keep this principle of attracting our energy bodies into this gross level here, so that this destructivity here can then end up reverberating throughout the other realms and bringing chaos to those other realms. That's what takes place, and that is literally what has taken place here at this time. All these attractive bodies saying, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. All these fashion shows, putting on all these, you know, fashion shows of beautiful bodies and all these beautiful patterns and beautiful textiles and fashions, all these beautiful stars, all these different beautiful stars. Everything that's being done here to attract us to this realm, to keep our attention, keep us thinking there's something we want here. It's all being done purposefully, intentionally set up the brutality so that our Our desire, our want is here. We're not paying attention to reason, because reason says there's nothing here that you really want. And if we think we're seeing all sorts of stuff we want, well, we won't listen to reason. We'll say, ah, reason, you're crazy. Why are you telling me there's nothing here I want? I see all sorts of stuff that I really want. That's how, when a planet's being set up to be extremely brutalized, what happens is first you bring in these waves and waves of beautiful bodies, of beautiful textiles, of beautiful fashions, of glamorous facades, of all this makeup, of all this gloss, of everyone looking very sexy. Sexy bodies is the whole thing. Okay, that's the whole, this whole sexy body type of thing, that comes in first. So everybody looks really attractive, you know, which is where we're at in this world. You know, if you compare this world now to what it was 50 years ago, 100 years ago, it's unbelievable. Everyone has beautiful teeth. Everyone has beautiful hair. Everyone has beautiful makeup. Everyone has beautiful complexions. Everyone has beautiful clothes. Everyone seems to have wonderful health. Everyone seems to be in love with beautiful bodies. Everyone's very sexy, you know. The whole thing, compared to what it used to be, it's night and day. All of this comes in first to, that's the sirens that come in to attract us, to keep our attention here at the gross, subtle level, to keep us from listening to reason, because we think that there's all sorts of stuff we want now. We think, oh my gosh, we live in a paradise here with all these beautiful, sexy people. That's all done intentionally, so that then the brutality can come in and brutalize this realm. And all our wants and all our desires are here. We think we're losing everything, and that causes reverberation through the subtle levels. Which is why all those who warned us about this in advance, some of the religions have, always insisted, no, do not develop the body beautiful culture, the sexy body culture. They absolutely proscribed that, said, no, that is sinful, that is wrong. Of course, and they were absolutely right about that. Because this happens, the brutalization has been taking place in the beginning of existence, as it were. So the wisdom and understanding of this is very well known. So those who know this come to this world and teach it and set up ways to warn us about this and say, do not develop the body beautiful culture, that pagan culture which is focused on the body beautiful, which is exactly what we've done here. And it's extremely intense right now. Extremely intense. Which is why I told you, don't watch the Olympics, because the Olympics is designed to fixate, to get a new high watermark of fixation upon the body beautiful, the body sexy, all of that, which, as it were, ensnares you. It binds you to this realm, which is where the brutality will be carried out. I'll get some water. So the warnings of the wise ones are should be heeded. What do you see in the Olympics except young, beautiful bodies, so capable? So, you know, you marvel, say, oh my gosh, look at these, such healthy, capable, attractive bodies here. It's a glorification of all of that. And you say, oh, it's so pure, it's so innocent, it's so wonderful. And then you end up getting caught up in all the sleaze also in the world that feeds off the body beautiful concept, the whole concept of the beautiful body. And, you know, that there's just the clothing available in the world now, the fashions, the way that people are able to clothe their bodies and the attitudes their bodies are put on. It's just like, you know, look at me, I'm a sex goddess. Look at me, I'm a hero god, you know, I'm a beautiful god that is infatuated with the sex goddesses, you know. That's the whole thing. and the teaching of the Dark Ones, who are studying the Spirituality, they teach that the men are supposed to be worshipping these sex goddesses, worship the females who are able to dress and present themselves as these glamorous sex goddesses. That the idea is that men are supposed to be entranced by that and worshipping them. That is the whole teaching that is setting up this brutality in the world to come, that is to come very soon. So, in no way, shape, or form is anyone supposed to worship anybody here, okay? What we're supposed to be doing is we're supposed to be listening to the voice of reason. The voice of reason doesn't have a body. We're supposed to be listening to the voice of reason, which clarifies the total trap for us. We're not supposed to be paying attention to bodies, worshiping bodies. We're not supposed to be listening to anybody who says anything like that. Okay? Because that's the Antichrist. That's the opposite of what we're supposed to be doing. When we mean Antichrist, it means anti-vision of Christ. The anti-vision of Christ is trying to distract us away from that, is having us focus on bodies more and more and more and more and more, even to the point of saying that we're supposed to be worshiping bodies, like men are supposed to be worshiping the feminine, worshiping the goddesses, these glamorous, beautiful, you know, Amazonian pagan goddesses that the world is absolutely flooded with now. And all the females on the planet are very much into this whole ideal, this whole notion, presenting themselves that way. And they are insistent that the men worship them. Okay, all of this is a setup. And the males are severely caught up in this too, thinking that this is what they're supposed to do. This is the snare. This is how the snare works. Instead of listening to the voice of reason, which is not a body, which has no clothing, no body, no clothing, no appearance whatsoever, no form at all. The voice of reason has no form. It's formless. And yet it gives us clarification. That is what we're supposed to be doing. That is the only safety there really is. Because it will, again, lay out the totality of the trap that existence really is and the remedy, which is the vision of Christ. It will make it very clear. So again, I need to point this out. I said, don't watch the Olympics. Whatever you do, don't watch it. Because that's like the final nail in the coffin that this plan of brutality is counting upon, is that people, it pushes it over the top, as it were. And all the advertising, you know, it's the advertising that is the worst thing. All of culture, all of civilization, all of this world has been seduced by the advertising, these glossy images and these beautiful people. And of course, females have been used more than males because females are able to present a much more beautiful picture, image of a body. For some reason, the skin and just the way the body is, the feminine body, is able to look more attractive than the male body, way more attractive. And so it's been utilized in advertising and marketing to bring about an entire culture of fixation on the body beautiful. Which again is what is binding us in this trap. Those are the binds. That's how we're being bound to this trap, where we will find our energy bodies brutalized here in this world. The brutalization of both physical, the way it will happen, will reverberate through the subtle realms, subtle energy realms. Which is why, again, religions always stressed, do not focus on the body beautiful. That is the number one stress of all religion. Very important. Focus on the voice of reason. Focus on the vision of Christ. It's the right message. And of course, those who are setting up this trap have tried to brutalize religion and saying how it's so wicked, it's so evil, it's so hateful, it's so biased. Of course, because it literally shows the way to escape this brutalization. So, of course, those who want to annihilate all of existence can't stand that, you know. and they hate it. They hate the warnings. They hate people who have heeded these warnings to some extent. Very few have heeded it sufficiently, so that they've allowed reason to show the totality of a situation. So that's why many still feel a call to arms. Let's battle. Let's fight it. Let's fight. Now, reason will show you don't need to fight, because you have a vision of Christ for you, right there for you, which is not vulnerable at all. Has no vulnerability to loss whatsoever. And there's an entire realm, a paradise realm, that is completely free of any vulnerability. You have that, all of that for you. It's all there for you. So you don't need to fight. You don't need to fight against the wickedness, all this stuff. What you need to do is witness to truth, to defenselessness is your true safety. You need to witness to that. That is how people are saved. Resist not evil, said Jesus. Resist not evil. Resist not brutality. Resist not lust. That is the truth. In other words, turn to the voice of reason, which tells you, hey, you've got an entire realm waiting for you. Go there instead. It's not an energy-based realm. It appears similar to it, but it's not. So what I'm doing is laying it all on the line now. I said, don't watch the Olympics. Now you're just understanding why. And you may think, oh, it's no big deal. It is a big deal, because the stakes are high now. Really high. And you have to choose which way to go. Are you going to go the body beautiful? Or are you going to go vision of Christ? Those are the only two ways you can go. I may have to take a break here. Let's see. No, okay. And it's difficult. I mean, every time you try to go with vision of Christ, the ego tries to throw the body beautiful into you. It tries to fire your imagination with the body beautiful. Hold on a second, there's someone out here. So there's this immense struggle going on. You try to say, no, the vision of Christ is what I really want, and I want to listen to the voice of reason, clarify it, and then the world, the ego, the world insists, no, the body beautiful is the way to go. You must focus on the body beautiful. And then you say, no, that's not what I really want. So the way to go forward now is to ask yourself, what do I really want? Of course, when the body beautiful tries to fire your imagination, you will think, oh, I really want this. This is nice. I want this. But then ask yourself, wait a minute, is this what I really want? Really want? Then you'll say, no. It's not what I really want. It's what I want, but not what I really want. When the sex goddesses say, no, you must worship us. You must worship us. We're the body beautiful. You must learn to worship the body beautiful, and we're the means for you to do that. So worship us. You'll say, well, I want that. Then say, no, but I don't. It's not what I really want. And then you jump back and say, no. And that's the struggle that we're at. So you're not as in a hopeless situation. Because the world is absolutely flooded with the body beautiful ideal now. Man, just about, there's a high percentage of people in the world who are actively insisting on this, the body beautiful, and have lent themselves to this, many entirely, if that were possible. In other words, there are many who have lent themselves to the body beautiful plan, which is really the plan of brutality, and are out there going 100% doing this, doing exactly this. The whole movie industry, the whole advertising industry, the whole modeling industry, the whole marketing industry, and on on and on and on and on and on. That has all seeped down to the deepest. It is seeped down so far that children now are embodying this body beautiful ideal. Children. It is revolting, really. That now children are acting this way, dressing this way, embodying the ideal of the body beautiful. Horrifying. And that is all. Nobody says anything. Well, some do say this is just terrible. But most say, oh, yeah, that's great. They're getting with it at an earlier age. That's what the people think. Oh, isn't this wonderful? That this whole body beautiful deception is now being glommed onto by even children. Because it's inescapable. It's in every video, every movie, every video game, every form of entertainment. It's ubiquitous. Ubiquitous, it's everywhere. It's inescapable. It's like the world is suffused with it. And so it's a dire situation. Because children that come into this world, they have the capacity, great capacity, to say, wait a minute. Let me listen to the voice of reason here. And so it's an opportunity to get off to the right start here in this world. But now they are just being clobbered. The youth are just being clobbered by this. And the youth are now being expected to, you know, lead the way, because, you know, the youth have the beautiful bodies, as it were, like in the Olympics. And they're, you know, they're supposed to be acting in this way of Pied Pipers. You know, there's so many Pied Pipers of the body beautiful in this world. So many. And a vast amount of them are females. And we're taught this idea now that females can do no wrong in this world, which is just an utter deception. Females can do great wrong in this world because they have the capability to embody this body beautiful trap better than anyone, better than males, way better, way better. Men are just dilettantes at this. When you want to seduce a world into the body beautiful ideal so it sets it up for brutality, what you do is you send in the females, because they're expert at this. Expert at it. And, you know, they can make themselves seem like goddesses. And they even can sugarcoat themselves with all sorts of spiritual rhetoric, you know. They even can quote spiritual teachings, you know, as if they're somehow very spiritual we're doing, and they can mislead the entire world almost. That's why I call it the goddess of destructivity. Seems like a goddess. It's not. I was fortunate that I came across a true goddess, as it were, or actually that which is above all goddesses, Sri Anandamayi Ma. And she showed me what a real females is really like, or those who embody truth, looks like in feminine form. And I said, wow, this is what truth, how this is how truth acts in a feminine form. And by seeing that, I was able to realize that these glamour goddesses are not embodying truth. The goddess of destructivity, no matter how glamorous and sexy she may appear and beautiful, she's not embodying truth. She's embodying a lie. She's embodying the deception, which is setting us up, entrapping us for brutality, for our energy bodies to be destroyed, brutalized. And Sri Anandamayi Ma enabled me to see this. She gave the example. I said, wow, I just compared. I said, oh, holy cow. I mean, she was just immaculate in her modesty, totally, and her unwillingness to present herself as anything other than the humblest, plainest type of person. And even though many people tried to dress her up, make her look beautiful, she, you know, she did not care the slightest bit for her appearance. And she embodied all the qualities that the feminine guided by truth embody. You know, total modesty. Total modesty. In all ways. Not the slightest attempt to mislead anyone here. And so, by having that example, I was able to, you know, to recognize what's going on in the world with the feminine and stand up to it and say, hey, you know, it doesn't matter how many scriptures you quote, you know, I could see that there are those in the feminine, many, many in the world who are pretending to be spiritual teachers, but are just leading the world astray. Setting up this massive sacrifice here. This is more than a sacrifice. It's brutality. It's massive brutalization. So I've taken it a step further. It's beyond sacrifice. It's not just sacrifice of the body. It's brutalization. It's using the body, brutalizing the body to reverberate through the subtle realms. It's an attempt to destroy the subtle realms is what it really is. And so all the glamour pusses were sent down here to, you know, catch your attention and think, hey, there's something we really want here. We all came down, you know. And it's just so blatantly obvious. It's a shame that anyone could be seduced by it. But it's been gradual. It's been gradual, step by step by step. You know, we didn't realize what was really happening. The last thing we expected is for the feminine in this world to go bad, you know. Just didn't expect it. Came from an angle we didn't expect, because throughout the ages, the feminine embodied restraint and modesty, and spoke against the body beautiful, and spoke out against it. You know, they were the embodied modesty, and the embodied not the opposite of the body beautiful, and so for the trap to come from the feminine was very unexpected, and it caught the world off guard. Because we respect the mother, we respect the modesty of the mother here, especially men. You know, everyone greatly respects it throughout history. We've respected the fact that the mother principle kept the reins on the body beautiful, and gave us, enabled us to at least breathe and listen to the voice of reason. So we didn't expect it, and we respected this principle so much that when the trap came from that angle, we kind of said, wait a minute, we can't speak out about this, because to do so would be a dishonor of the mother. We can't dishonor the mother by speaking out about this. In other words, the entire trap, the major trap came from, hid under the skirts of motherhood. And the great mother and motherhood hid under those skirts. And so we could not speak openly about it out of being charged with disrespecting, you know, motherhood, the mother, and females, et cetera, as if we'd be disrespecting them. And those who did speak out about it were rejected and ostracized as being misogynist or anti-female, anti-woman, etc., 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 which is nothing further than the truth. What they were saying was that the plan to brutalize existence and to annihilate existence, coming into this world, saw the way to do it, which was to hide under the skirts of motherhood, to bring about this body beautiful culture. These horrors of existence came into the world and hid under the decent skirts of decent women here. The decency of femininity in the world, they used it as a facade, as a cover for what they were doing. And then they brought this whole whorish civilization, this body beautiful culture, the sexy body culture. They brought all of that. They built it up. And when anyone ever said anything about that, they say, oh, you're attacking women or something like that. You know, you're attacking something that's very venerable, very clever, very, very clever, but very predictable too. Very predictable. And very blatant. It's actually been blatant, but again, everyone's been restrained from saying anything about it. So, you know, people still are, you know, struggling and they're tongue-tied. They say, I don't want to, you know, speak up about this and say anything bad about women. No way, you know. The women are wonderful. They're wonderful, you know. What is wonderful is the voice of reason. What is wonderful is unconditional love. What is wonderful is reality. That's what's wonderful. What is wonderful is the vision of Christ. No woman in this world who is oriented towards truth wants to be worshipped, that wants to be told how wonderful they are. No. I mean, they're meek, they're humble, they realize that they don't want to be utilized to build up this body beautiful deception. So they're not asking to be worshipped to be looked at as glamorous and beautiful and attractive. No way. Because they realize that's a trap. It's going to result in their brutalization too. Everyone will be brutalized by that. So they refuse to be used in that way. But unfortunately, modern culture found a way to trick many females into, they agreed to be utilized in this way to build up the body beautiful. And they will end up deeply, deeply regretting that to the utmost. And of course, any men that say, hey, you know, wait a minute, what's going on? They were just looked at as crazy. Oh, these men, crazy. Don't listen to them. They're crazy. They're evil. They're bad, etc. All this stuff. That's what has taken place in this world. It's the truth. I know some of you realize that. That is true. There are a lot. Most of us realize this. It's just that we can't say it. And we can't even think it. You know, I'm not asking anyone to think it or say it or anything like that. But to intuitively realize the voice of reason has not been told by any of us, okay? So trust the voice of reason. Don't trust me. Trust the voice of reason. I'm just a witness to it. But I'm not asking me to be trusted, as it were. I'm saying the voice of reason can be trusted because the voice of reason saw through this thing the entire way. It showed it to me. It says, look what's happening. And I looked and I saw it and I said, yeah. I said, but I don't dare say anything about this. I mean, my gosh. And the voice reason says, yeah, don't say anything about it. It's too dangerous for you right now. Don't say anything. But just look. Just see what's happening. And I said, okay. I said, oh my gosh. You know, these people, they're quoting sacred scriptures, but twisting it to make it seem like we're supposed to be worshiping women or something. So what are they talking about? That's crazy. That's evil. That's wrong. And the voice reason would just say, okay, just notice it. Just see it. No problem. Don't worry. Keep going. I say, okay. Don't say anything. Just I kept looking and looking and say, holy cow. I said, this is going in a bad direction. Really, really bad direction. And the voice of reason would say, yeah, it's going in a terrible direction, but don't worry. Okay. And I said, gosh, you know, if I say anything about it, no one will listen to me anyway because I'm a man. And the voice of reason says, yeah, probably not. Probably not many will listen. Because we've been taught not that wisdom comes from women now, it doesn't come from men. And those who are setting up this brutality, that's what they've advanced, because their agents, these sex goddesses, body beautiful, building up this body beautiful, as it were, culture, were being taught to only pay attention to that. And since, you know, since women are taking the lead in this, the feminists taking the lead in this, we're taught to discount anything that men say, that men can't speak truth at all. So very few will listen. If mostly people in the world now will only listen to truth if a woman, a female, is saying it. They won't listen to a man. They'll discount it. And the only way that a man can be listened to is if they have a whole bunch of females around them basically controlling the situation, reassuring, don't worry everybody, we're really in control of this. Then maybe people will listen a little bit. But just listening to a man without this whole entourage of females around them, very, very few will listen to that right now, because we've been acculturated to believe that truth comes from females now, because it's the females who have taken the lead in this whole process of acculturating the body beautiful culture, which is literally the way we're being entrapped so that we're going to experience this massive brutality in the world that is coming. That's literally what is taking place. So hopefully there are some in this world who can still listen to wisdom, even though it comes from a man, you see, male form, as it were. But I'm seeing not many. because in this world you literally cannot criticize the females at all. Zero criticism. It's like there's zero tolerance for any criticism whatsoever. But of course, what I'm not criticizing, I'm pointing out the totality of what is happening. That's different, because it's all part of this plan of existence and trying to annihilate itself in the need to entrap our attention here at the gross physical level, so that the brutalization of this level can, as it were, echo through the other levels and cause chaos in those other levels. And in order to do this, we have to think there's something here in this world we really want. Okay, now, what is it? Well, the body beautiful is what's used to think of what we really want. And the feminine, the body beautiful, the feminine entraps men thinking, oh my gosh, look at all these gorgeous sex goddesses. All these women are so beautiful now. And we think, I want that. And then the females look at these gorgeous women and they think, oh, I want that. I want to be that beautiful. You know? They're looking at all these fashion shows, these models about all these beautiful costumes they're wearing and attitudes and glamour. And they think, oh my gosh, I really want to be like that. I want to be gorgeous and beautiful, so that as I walk, the men fall at my feet and say, I'll do anything for you. I'll build an entire kingdom for you. You're so beautiful. So we're all being entrapped by that. The women are entrapped by it, by wanting to be that glamorous and beautiful and have this magic of power over men. And the men are attracted to it naturally, by the natural attraction that men have for beautiful, sexy females, you know. So it's entrapping the whole world. The whole world's being entrapped by it. And anyone who tries to wiggle free, you know, they're hateful. They're hateful. Well, they hate being brutalized is what they really hate. They don't want to be brutalized anymore, so of course they want to get free of it. Of course. Everybody wants to get free of it. We just don't feel we're entitled to. We don't want to disrespect the feminine, etc. But I tell you this, that the real wisdom of anyone in feminine form, etc., will say, oh, no, don't worship the body beautiful, don't worship the feminine, no. Listen to the voice of reason. And Ananda Maya Ma was one of the most beautiful looking people that's ever been on this planet, naturally so. But she said, listen to the voice of reason. You must do that. Don't pay any attention to the body beautiful. Listen to the voice of reason. She didn't have any interest in being glamorized. They tried to use her that way, but she said, no. That's not what I'm here for. Be totally modest. She told women to be totally modest. Okay? That's what she told them. And look up to men, as it were. Don't allow yourself to get trapped into that game of trying to use your beauty to have power over men. Don't do that. She said that is a road for your own brutalization. You will think you're gaining power, but what happens is you're being trapped into this whole energy scenario which is going to be brutalized. Okay? So it's very strict about that. No nonsense about that. The women into her were expected to be renunciates, you know, wear the white, no makeup, no adornment, none of that. The basic teaching is no makeup, no adornment whatsoever, and simple, basic clothing that don't show off the form at all. That has always been the correct and right teaching. Always. And it remains so to this day. And how many are following that? Very few. Very few. And the culture wars are really over that, to tell you the truth. Is this body beautiful culture is trying to force this ideal on the entire planet. And of course there are those who resist that. There are some feminine areas of the planet that resist this, who insist on feminine modesty, which is the right path. And then the path of the body beautiful, you know, is this Frankenstein monster that, you know, say to men, your whole purpose here is to beautify the female by everything she wants, all the beauty treatments she wants, build all the homes she wants, give her all the cars she wants, turn her into a goddess. You're supposed to be a slave to that principle of turning the feminine into a goddess. Again, all of this is simply how we are entrapped. Our attention and our desire and our belief, everything is fixated at this level. So then our energy can be brutalized at this level, and this will flood through the other levels of energy. That's all that it's serving. It's totally in the service of this plan of brutalization. So you might say it's totally anti-Christ. It's totally anti you listening to the voice of reason, which leads you to the vision of Christ. It's totally opposite of that. It's working against it. All right? And I don't hear anyone speaking out about this. This is the first time I've spoken out about this. I haven't heard anyone else say this. Really. There have been a couple of attempts to shout, hey, there's a problem here, hey, problem here. And they got slapped down, to say the least. But this is. I only wanted to speak out about this when I could put it in the right context, in the totality of the situation, which I'm doing. See, I'm not anti anything. I'm pro truth. I'm pro listening to the voice of reason. I'm pro everyone escaping this nightmare. That's what I'm pro for. So I'm only pointing this out to guide you to that objective, to the vision of Christ. That's the only reason. There's no hate here. There's no spirit of hate. But there are red flags. I'm tossing out the red flags saying, look, the spirit of hate is in the world. The very ones who are screaming about hate, they are the ones who have the spirit of hate in this world. They want this brutalization to take place. They're setting everyone up to be brutalized because they believe that by destroying total annihilation will result in a rebirth, like a phoenix-like rebirth, where they will be prime creators of a new reality. That's what they believe. So they're pursuing this annihilation. And we call this pursuit of annihilation hate. They want to destroy everything. They want everything to be brutalized here. And anyone who tries to wiggle free of this trap, they say that they're being hateful. They're accused of hate, which is just a complete projection. So, again, the way to go towards safety now is to apply this principle. It's to say, yes, I do want all this stuff. I do want what the Body Beautiful seems to be offering me, which is like a hedonistic paradise, right? Unbelievably perfect, flawless, sexy bodies, you know. Eternal, youthful, sexy bodies that look just glamorous and gorgeous all the time, etc., etc. Say, yes, I want that, but it's not what I really want, okay? I'm giving you the key to getting free, going in the direction where safety is here. And you must try this. Say, yes, I want it, but it's not what I really want. And so I'm going to go get what I really want, okay? Because the vision of Christ is what you really want. Don't deny what your energy bodies think they want, because that is futile. It is absolutely futile. It's going to ruin you. Don't fight against it. Say, no, I don't want that. I don't want that. Of course you want it. Of course the women want to look like they're eternally youthful, unbelievably beautiful, graceful goddesses. You know, of course they want that, but it's not what they really want. And of course the men want to live in a world where they're surrounded by these, you know, perfect women, of course. But it's not what they really want. It's not what they really want, you see. So don't deny that the energy bodies are attracted to all this. Just affirm that it's not what you really want, which is at the level of spirit. So spirit has to speak and say, okay, energy bodies, I see what you want, but I know what I really want, you see. That's spiritual. That's real spiritual teaching, okay? Where spirit says, I'm going to go to what I really want, which is to drop this whole crazy attempt to be prime creator. That's what I really want. I really want that. This other stuff, Of course I want it. Everything, all these symbols that I made want it, because I made them to want it. I made them to be attracted to their own destruction. So of course they're going to be attracted to that. Don't fight against that, but just say, no, but it's not what I really want. And therein lies the key here towards staying with the voice of reason and thereby being guided towards the vision of Christ. Okay? This is the key. And all those people are screaming, oh, this is hateful, what you say is hateful. I know that's not true at all, because I know there's a vast number of people on this planet that want to hear this. And including women, you think, oh, you exposed, you brought to light what's going on. There's a vast number of those who have female bodies, as it is, who they don't want to go along with this brutality at all. They can't stand the pressure on them to become these sex goddesses. They can't stand it. They want to be simple. They want to be humble. They want to be modest. They want society to turn towards the voice of truth, and they want to be freed of this brutality. That's what they really want. But the pressure on them is so severe. Pressure on everybody is so severe. Nobody can hardly say this anymore. And same with men. What men really want is they really want to be surrounded by modest females. That is the truth. That is what men want in this world. They really want very modest females who are not trying to play that game of sexual attraction, glamorous attraction at all. That are very down to earth, very basic, very modest, very humble. Do not adorn themselves. Do not make themselves up, make themselves attractive. That they want intelligent, wise women. They want to be surrounded by that, which will enable, give the men, again, the freedom to turn to the voice of reason. In other words, when the men turn to the voice of reason and they're paying attention, they don't have these females coming, what are you doing? What are you doing? How come you're wasting your time with this? You know, how come you're not making me more beautiful? How come you're not working harder, getting more money? I want a new car. You know, look at my house. Look, I want a new house. Look at my clothing. I'm wearing the same stuff. I want a new wardrobe. I want this. And here you are, sitting here quietly with your eyes closed. You spend all day. You spend 8 hours a day doing that and not going out. What a worthless man you are. How terrible you are. You know, they don't want to hear that. They don't want to hear that. And the wise women, the modest women, the women who understand that they too need to be freed from truth, and this path of body beautiful and being a glamorous goddess is not the way to go. They're happy to see the men turning towards the voice of reason, spending their time that way, because they know this will rebound to them as well, very strongly. And the men won't demand of them that they spend all their time, you know, primping and spend all their time in front of the mirror. The females too will have the time to quietly meditate, right? That the men are not demanding that the females be these beautiful goddesses. So it works both ways, you see, both ways. So both men, male and female here, when they reject the body beautiful culture, it works to both of their benefits. They both give each other the time to listen to the voice of reason. It's a win-win. Win-win. But generally, this culture always starts with the feminine because they have more power here. They have the power of attraction. And if they insist that the men pay attention to their attractiveness, the men will get distracted. But when the females decide, we're going to be modest, and we're going to not try to attract the male's attention like that, the men automatically, they say, whew, thank God. You know, thank God I can, because that's not what I really want. And they can start paying attention to the voice of reason, and the whole culture and whole society goes in the right direction. But right now, it's a disaster in this world. 100% in the wrong direction. It is so severely in the wrong direction. It is an avalanche. And so, you know, it's culturally, it's a disaster. But still, there are those who are able to speak out and explain what's going on. And we can still turn to the voice of truth. I'm given that opportunity. My wife allows me this opportunity, you know? Because she knows I'm doing something that's very, very helpful, and that's what I really want to do. She's able to determine the difference between what we want to do and what we really want to do. And she knows this is what I really want to do, whereas the other stuff I just, you know, want to do it. There's a difference. Every single person on this planet has a capability of making that determination. And throughout history, there have been, you know, many wise cultures where the women were perfectly clear about that. And so were the men. Very clear. They understood perfectly clear. And there's still many in the world that do. There's still many women in the world that are clear about this. The difference between what we want to do and what we really want. What men want to do, how men want to see them, and how they really want to see them, etc., etc., right? But that differentiation has become blurred in people through the intimidation tactics and the bullying tactics. I'll tell you, those who are pushing this body beautiful culture are bullies. They are severe bullies. And they are bullying the world into this body beautiful culture. They are bullying the world into this. And anyone who stands up to those bullies is claimed to be a hateful, terrible, wicked person, you know? That's what's happening. And so many of us have been intimidated by these bullying tactics. So we've kind of lost sight between what we want and what we really want. Okay? That's real love. In this world, the love in this world is shown by allowing each other to pursue what we really want instead of just what we want. That is love in this world. It's not the same thing as a vision of Christ. Unconditional love is different. But what we're supposed to do in this world is differentiate between what we want and what we really want and allow each other to pursue what we really want. That's, in other words, we're accepting unconditional love, the vision of Christ, as a goal. Okay, that's what we're doing. Hatred is to turn us away from that, is to turn us towards what we want and reject what we really want and refuse to give us any time to focus on what we really want. That's, you know, that's hatred, that's antichrist, that's the desire to destroy ourselves, self-destructivity. And that voice is the bully voice in the world now, that's bullying the world. We're all being bullied. I always stood up to bullies, and I wasn't easily bullied. In school, generally, the bullies left me alone. I even had a locker. I had a locker in junior high school right next to the worst bully that you will ever see. Everybody in the school were just terrified of this bully. And my locker was literally right on beside his. My gosh. And it scared me. I was scared. I thought he was going to kill me. And I went through all, you know, sixth, seventh, eighth grade with my locker. Not sixth and seventh grade, because he graduated. He was 1 year ahead of me. With my locker right next to his. And I basically was afraid to go to my locker, you know? But he respected me. He didn't bully me. Because something in, you know, something about me just, I better pass this guy over. I better pass him over. But he was a holy terror, I'm telling you. Eventually, I heard he met a very untimely demise. I guess he tried to bully the wrong people. But there were bullies in the school, and they didn't mess with me. And so, you know, I've always been very anti-bully. I don't like bullies, but the fact is the whole world is being bullied now, severely. So this video is a way to, you know, it stands up to them, but that's not my purpose. My purpose is to turn people to truth, to safety, to getting free from the bullies. Okay, because the bullies will not relent. They got their marching orders. It's part of the dynamic of existence. They literally feel that their very identity and existence depends on them brutalizing this world. And if they fail to do it, they feel they're going to be annihilated. So you can sing all the songs on their face you want to. It doesn't matter to them. They literally are driven by the fear of annihilation. It's crazy. Existence is completely crazy. Existence feels it needs to annihilate itself in order to not be annihilated. It's a contradiction, isn't it? But existence feels the only way it can be saved is to destroy itself. And so, you know, you're up against this. And you cannot reason with that dynamic. Reason doesn't reason with existence. Reason shows you the remedy for existence. It doesn't try to reason with existence. It doesn't try to change existence. It cannot. Existence is completely insane. Reason just says, look, turn to sanity. Turn to a sane idea. Give up the idea of trying to become prime creator. Give up this whole scenario of loss. It's crazy. Drop it, you know. Choose the vision of Christ instead. Reason doesn't try to reason with insanity. We cannot. Insanity is insanity. There's no way to reason with it. So these bullies who are bringing this reign of terror upon the earth, this brutality, reign of brutality, you can't reason with them. You cannot. You can only have them pass you over, which is why I say the Passover principle is all important, because insanity will pass by sanity. It will pass it by, because it will say, ah, there's nothing here. I must pass this by. So it's the Passover principle that saves you. And the voice of reason will clarify that Passover principle for you, so you can say, ah, that's what I really want. Okay? The whole problem is we're confused about what we want and what we really want. And in this world now, we're profoundly confused about it. Profoundly confused about it. And we're afraid to listen to the truth because we think we might be able to escape brutality by just kind of playing along appeasement. We know how that worked out in World War II, appeasement. If we just play along and appease, and then the bullies will say, oh, they're good gents, you know, nice ladies and gentlemen, not going to bother them. Let's just use good manners in their direction, as if that's going to work. It won't work. It doesn't work. Again, these bullies are driven by the fear of their own annihilation if they don't succeed. So they're not going to listen to reason. They don't listen to reason. That's why. But they have to pass over Christ, truth, sanity, unconditional love. They have to pass over that. They got no choice in that. They have no choice in it whatsoever. They bluff you by saying that you have to appease them, that they can choose, they can annihilate everything, and they'll choose. They have no choice in this whatsoever. They have to pass this by, because for them, they look at it, they look at reality, and they see their own annihilation there, and they have to pass it by. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. So don't listen to their lies thinking that they have the discretion to destroy everything. They do not. They can see everything. They cannot see everything. That there's nothing that they will pass by. That is a lie. Because they believe they have to destroy all of existence. So they say there's nothing that we will pass by. Yeah, in existence. But they completely pass by reality. They cannot see it. They cannot touch it. And if you are aligned with reality, they have to pass you by. No matter what they say. No matter how they boast, you know, the boasting of a bully, right? Bullies are very boastful. And they say they're going to break everybody's heads, you know, but no. Don't even pay any attention to what the bully says. Bully has to pass you by. So don't even engage in a dialogue with them. It's useless, because their whole dialogue is just trying to intimidate you about how they're going to leave nothing unscathed. And you know that is completely delusional. And yet you can never convince them otherwise. So turn to the vision of Christ. Turn to the voice of reason. Clarify that the vision of Christ is the way, and you will be passed by. This is the Passover principle. That is the purpose of what I'm talking about. Is your safety. Is your freedom from this bullying, from this brutality. I don't want anybody to go through that. Because you don't have to. I certainly don't want to go through it. I've already been through the annihilation of my energy bodies. I don't want to go through it again. I see what it results in, which is what I don't want it. Not what I really want. I thought it was what I wanted, and now I found out it's not what I really want. Again, differentiate between what you want and what you really want. Okay? You can do it. You can do it. We all can do this. Because what we really want is we don't want to experience any more loss, right? We want to experience carefreeness. We want to experience eternal delight. We want to experience the richness of reality. We want to experience this boundless freedom. That is what we really want. This other stuff, we don't really want it. And we're entitled to choose what we really want. We're absolutely entitled to it. Pre-qualified to accept what we really want. And the vision of Christ gives us that reflection of what we really want, perfect reflection. And we say, ah, I really want this reflection. So let's stick with that. Say, I really want this reflection of what I really want, this perfect reflection of what I really want. I really want this vision of Christ. And I can have it. I can have it bestowed upon me. If I'm clear that this is what I really want, and I'm not fighting against what I want, I can say, well, this doesn't give me what I want, but it is giving me what I really want. And so there's no inner conflict that way, you see. There's no inner struggle. If you don't see bodies anymore, beautiful bodies, you say, well, okay, I'm not seeing what I want, but I am seeing what I really want. So where's the conflict there? So, okay, you're not fighting it. The ego, you know, the bullies will say, ah, you're not seeing beautiful bodies anymore. You're being so deprived of what you want. And you say, yeah, I'm being deprived of what I want, but I'm not being deprived of what I really want. See, that's the truth. That's how it works. This is the key. This is the way around the end run around the bullies. Make your end run around the bullies. Just say, yeah, agree with it. Jesus said, agree with your adversary. Okay? This is another key that Jesus taught. This is why its channel is called Christ Clarity. That's what it's about. He said, agree with your adversary. So the adversary says, ah, you're being deprived of what you want, you poor, miserable son of a gun, you know. How wretched you must be, you're being deprived of what you want. You smile and say, yes, 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 I am being deprived of what I want, but I am getting what I really want, perfectly, flawlessly. And that's great, that's great. And see? And then the adversary, you know, has to pass you by, say, ah, this one's crazy. I got to pass them by. They're insane. They don't understand what I'm talking about. Okay. So sure, yeah. I'm going to be deprived of what I want. No problem. But I'm not going to be deprived of what I really want. I'm going to get that flawlessly. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Hallelujah, as they say. So don't disagree with the adversary, the bully. Don't disagree with the bully. Just say, yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, sure. I'm being deprived of all of what I want. Great. Great, great, great. That's great. Because I'm getting what I really want. In exchange for that, I'm getting what I really want. Nice deal. It's like you're handing over nothing and getting everything. Because there's nothing in existence of what I really want. Nothing. What I really want cannot be found in existence whatsoever. Never. So, by giving up existence, seeing existence as the loss-based scenario, what kind of loss is that? I'm only losing attractive forms of loss. This body beautiful thing, after all, those are only attractive forms of loss, right? That's all it really is. And I think I want it, but I don't really want it. See? So we're moving here, moving forward. This is, what today is? This is a Saturday morning, and it's the 4th of August, and just a second. Just 1 second. Yep. And maybe we're going to end the video right now. It's probably time. So, very great. It's been a tremendous pleasure sharing this with you. And that's it for this video.